exhibition on him, Space Caribbean in Jamaica, was doing some work on him, and then also there was a plaque that was put in his honor in Paris. At that time, no plaque existed for Basquiat in New York City. And after that year-long of programming, it just so happened that Greenwich Village Society for Historic Preservation decided to dedicate a plaque for him last July in his honor. The plaque is literally on this block, so when you walk out to your right, you can go and see the plaque, which was basically Basquiat's studio when he was alive. It is now a tech startup, which is very symbolic of this neighborhood and the ways that it's changed. Greenwich Village Society for Historic Preservation has been incredible in terms of having conversations around gentrification and housing, particularly in this neighborhood. I would like to take this time to acknowledge Chelsea Dole, who's at the back in the white t-shirt. We actually connected last summer, and she's been incredible in terms of both help and support for this panel. I am indebted to many people, clearly Janelle Ajani, who was very pivotal in terms of my thought process around this project. We did a symposium last year. If you want, you can actually look at NYU IAAA's website to see the conference, which was very in-depth last year. And now I'm going to take a moment to introduce our lovely panelists. So, to my far right is Patty Oster. Patty Oster ran the Fun Gallery in downtown New York. She's participated in a series of films and is going to speak to much of the history of this neighborhood. Then we have Yasmin Ramirez, who's a professor at CUNY Hunter, and has done extensive work on Puerto Rican history, the art scene, and was also a friend and peer of Jean Michel. Then we have Shazia Lagouan, and who's a researcher, a writer, and journalist. last name, who's done extensive work, not just around Black Lives Matter, police brutality, and women's rights, but has done extensive work on a project that's called Basquiat's Defacement, which you will see. And then I have Naomi Guerrero, who started an online journal called Gallery Girl NYC. She's a Dominican writer, talks about the art scene, and I've had the pleasure of meeting her through New York University. So thank you all for being here today, and we'll start.
bike clubs, and we all go down to the bike club. And by this time, I'm a celebrity time, so. And I bet John Michelle on the stairway up to the VIP room of the bike club. I didn't know who he was. I thought he was just a homeless, cute kid. I used to tease him about his weird hairdo and all. I can see it plain as day, just the two of us on the stairway. And I was like, you know, we were just flirting. And so that's how I got to know John Michelle. And then this whole art shit, as Deborah calls it, got started. And the first really influential show, other than the ones that were at Fashion Moda up in the South Bronx, I gotta give them credit, were there was a Times Square show, but then the one that really hit home, world was lily white. The crowds, however hip, were less told me it wasn't coming out until everyone was gone. So I congratulated him and left, feeling a little sad. Then he got hooked up with, then he got sick of the treatment of India, then he got hooked up with Bruno Bischofberger. He was really excited. Bruno Bischofberger, huge dealer, biggest dealer in the art world. Blew him over to Zurich. He's like, great, I made it. You know, now I'm like really respected part of the art world. Bruno picked him up in the airport in a limousine and drove him directly to the gallery, not stopping at a hotel after an international flight, and set him up in the gallery so people could watch him paint. So he went through with that and came back, and we had many, we were friends. We had many private conversations. He was crying when he told us. And now Bruno Bischofberger was his best friend. Then he went through the Mary Boone debacle. That was a nightmare. Then Rene Ricard, very influential art critic and poet, artist in his own right, Warhol star. We've been friends forever. Rene loved the Fun Gallery, the pop, everything. He was, you know, in his series of articles in art form, you know, Mondo. He did the Radiant Child thing. He went to John, he said, look, John, Patty's got the gallery now. We moved to the big gallery. He said, Patty's got the gallery now. Come. So he did. Where are we? Let's go to the what's that? Oh, okay. The next one, the limitation. Then we should have, that's always here. Oh, what happened at, there we go. Courage, courage. Kennedy's world, the Livas, the Wheeling and Dealing, the Armani suits. A vacuum is defined as a space void of matter. Another trend is to remember him as doomed. In the Hoban biography, the overall effect is a stun of is a stunned bystander's gaping at a particularly horrific car accident. I always picture him with a sunny smile and a sly and mischievous look, the same sexy rebel outcast I met on the staircase of the balcony. A1, another great fun gallery artist, would say in New Yorker magazine, a vandal is somebody who throws a brick through a window. An artist is somebody who paints a picture on that window. A great artist is somebody who paints a picture on the window and then throws a brick through. Aren't all great talents outlaws who break all the rules? John Michel was one of the few who always got my anti-establishment antics. I had the greatest respect for his intelligence, sharp political edge, and masterly paint. If only I could have seen. Everyone gathered to mourn at the makeshift voodoo shrine outside his loft. The art world pundits rushed to gavel and pontificate among the flickering candles. Motherfucker, said M5 Freddy. Thank you.
Got this space through his connections with Warhol. And I
ribs, you know, comping to the fact that we like soul food was always a little bit of a struggle for us. How do we negotiate? We want to be, you know, seen as cool. We want to be seen eating sushi. So, yeah, but we also want our soul food. So out getting ribs is that kind of thing where, you know, John is putting that out there that he is still a man of color. He is still getting those ribs, maybe. Maybe. Because if he saw that on the street at that time, who would think twice about it, right? So you kind of have to know that he's a man of color. It's more of an inside joke for us that he's putting that out there than what makes sense to anyone else. And I think saying a word like that, a lot of his words are kind of inside jokes. Right here is 1983. This piece is called A Popcorn. And right there, you see references to Gallery, Marianne Montfortin was mentioned there. Madonna, who he was dating in 1983. He had just, he got the studio in 1983. So Avenue A first, and then you see right down here, all of the spaces we were hanging out at. Avenue A, First Avenue, Second Avenue, Third Avenue, the Bowery, okay? So the Bowery for us was CBGB's. But also, what was really important, we knew that there were a lot of artists that had lived here. Mapleport lived around here. Chuck Close lived around here. But I think the person that we most related to was that John Burroughs. The bunker, which he left in 1981, was, you know, right here on the Bowery. So, you know, Burroughs was part of our imaginary. So were the abstract expressionists, which we knew lived in the East Village. So, right, I mean, we were
very much.
Know about the abstract expressions. We all knew that. We went to the museums. Rather than go to school, they don't teach us nothing. We are going to go to the museums. We're going to go to the Met. And that's something that myself, Fat Five Freddy, Jean, all of us were really interested in reading about our history. But we were self-taught. But John Burroughs was certainly, the fact that, you know, the Bowery, CBGBs, and John Burroughs was here, and the Beat Generation, and also the New York poets as well, all of that was in our imaginaries as to like what the Bowery was about. So let's go on to the next slide. Okay, so the other space that was really important was 611 Cable Building. So when you think about what the layout of our, the topography of the art world as I knew it back in the 80s. So Soho was the place for the galleries, and then the older artists from the 70s, they had spaces in Soho. So you would go over there. And then over here is where Jean was, and where we were hanging out, because the 611 building had the East Village, headquarters of the East Village Eye, had a whole bunch of independent record producers up in there. Brej Blakumian, who was Jean's dealer later on in the late 80s, he had his gallery there. What else was going on? Oh, he did. Keith Haring had one of his studios.
Yeah, that was great.
Right? There was always parties up in there.
Yeah,
so 611 Cable Building, which was not that far away, that was another kind of stomping ground. And that's me in the 611. The person up there. Right down there. That's me. Yeah, that's me. I was on the art staff, art writer staff. So I just want to give you the layout that, you know, with Jean Michel came a whole bunch of us around here. Even though we may not have lived around here, we was hanging out around here, we have business, and that's why I would see Jean. Okay, all right, the second kind of, so I want to talk about a little bit of the kinetics of this neighborhood within Jean's work. One of the prevalent themes of Jean's work is men of color, and particular concern with very famous and wealthy men of color, but also the homeless and the workers. So you know, you got those two kind of things. And here it is, food for the soup kitchen. I'm thinking about the Bowery. You know, at that time in particular, this place was teeming with the homeless, right? And if you read John's, if you know John, and if you read his works, he would be giving people money. Like it would be random, but he could be very generous. So every once in a while, if you read about what he did, he would give somebody, he would give a homeless person $50. He would, his mind was very concerned
talking to ask questions, and in particular, there's a group that I've asked to stop talking, and I'm not going to ask you again. So if you could please hold your questions and comments until after the talk. So for this defacement, there's so much to talk about. So for me, I'm just going to focus on defacement as it pertains to the East Village and the key players in that history that's unfolding literally every week. So my scholarship is about what this painting means, the forgotten history around that, and putting together the narratives for the first time. So this is defacement, the death of Michael Stewart. And what we think happened, we think that this was painted in October, November of 1983. And so I bookmarked that time because September 28, 1983 was when Michael Stewart was killed. And we know that by mid-December, looking at records, Basquiat was in LA at this time. So it's around this time. And so what that means is that with defacement, it was a painting that he thought about, it was an event that he thought about. And right now it's mostly positioned as kind of this moment in East Village history that he moved on from, but it seems as though, well, we know that a lot of painters at this time were commenting on Michael Stewart's death. How many of you have heard of Michael Stewart? So Michael Stewart, for those of you who don't know, Michael Stewart was a graffiti artist who was killed by the New York City Transit Police in 1983. And it was perhaps the most publicized case of police brutality post-civil rights, 1968, in New York City. And it started this conversation about police brutality that has obviously never gone away. And so I bring up Horn Players, and I'll also show this untitled 1982, the painting that just went up for auction, to show how different defacement is. Defacement is very, very singular in when you look at Basquiat's body of work, and that's because for Basquiat, this is a very minimalist painting. The history is incredibly rich. We know more about when this painting was created and also possible influences that we can track in ways that we don't know about almost a lot of his paintings. And my theory is personally is that part of my job with the scholarship and putting together a picture of what that narrative looks like is that defacement is devoid of the majesty that you see in a lot of Basquiat's paintings. So to your point that he concerned himself with a lot of famous black men, particularly athletes, I also noticed that in his paintings, like Horn Players, looking at aspects of black history and black figures, but using majesty to look at them and to metabolize the more traumatic aspects of the black experience. And defacement is absolutely devoid of any majestic or ennobling factor or variable to process Michael Stewart's death. And so what makes defacement so special? It's a minimalist work for him. The colors are very different from his usual palette. They're more aligned with Keith Haring's colors. And the reason why I bring up Keith Haring is because this painting was painted in Keith Haring's studio. So when he moved from the Cable Building to the studio where the foundation is currently set, the painting was moved and framed at that point. But the painting with, so we don't know exactly what happened. Common theory right now is that it was a spontaneous moment and he went over to Keith Haring's studio. But there have been other compositions from other artists that have disrupted that theory. Where it lands, we're not sure, but what I think is that it was something that he'd been thinking about and he went over to Keith Haring's studio for whatever reason and the painting happened at that time. It's hard to show, but it's hard to show some of the paintings or with the colors, but some of these colors are actually what we think were runoffs of what Keith Haring was working on at that time, such as the silver and parts of the orange. And also the use of black him. And I think that, at least in the in art criticism and gallery system, and absolutely scholastically. And so, to the other point that he was self-taught and that these kids were reading art history, they were educating themselves. A very common point in Painting 101 is that you don't use black, and that's a holdover from the Impressionists. And that is because black is a very difficult color to work with, and it vacuums the attention, so to speak. It vacuums the space on the canvas and creates a very difficult negative space to work with. So oftentimes when you see black on a canvas, what you're really seeing is a very, very dark brown or a very, very dark blue. But so in the process of using this black to represent Michael Stewart, he's also reaffirming that he knows what he's doing. He knows the rule that he's breaking. So he's acknowledging this kind of this rule from Impressionist painting, from the masters, and he's breaking it. And he's being very deliberate about it, and he wants you to know that he's breaking it. The copyright is also, right here, a very sophisticated play on what an actual copyright means. It's issued by the government to protect something, it's to protect a right. And so with this image of police brutality and with officers of the state, it's asking, and this is obviously Basquiat, police brutality being a common theme in his work, he's asking, well, whose rights are being protected? And the fact that this happens over and over again, is this a copyright on the state's right to abuse and violate the black body? And defacimento is an Italian word, and at this time you knew, you know, that he was becoming friends with Francesco Clemente, and so you can also tell sometimes when he meets new people, parts of their aspects of them show up in the canvas. And then there are references to Emery Douglas's work, Casas Guernica, possibly Disaster Before, and The Scream, finally. So, as I said, this painting was owned and stewarded by Keith Haring, and I think that that's an incredibly important point to mention. The painting also has a very beautiful gilded frame that we'll see at the end of the slide, and that was a frame that Keith Haring chose and selected and actually juxtaposed very uncomfortably as it's supposed to. And also Keith Haring, at 31, left it to a very special little girl who is now a woman and owns this painting. And a common question that I get is, well, if Keith Haring was trying to save this painting, why didn't he donate it to a museum? But in the context of 1990, when he died, in 1983, there was no museum that would have taken this work. Basquiat and Keith Haring had a hard enough time getting their works that were less politically explicit into major museums. And in interviewing one of Basquiat's, his last girlfriend before she died, Kelly Inman, she relayed to me that a couple of months before his death, or a few months before his death, Jean-Michel tried to get one of his paintings, he tried to donate it to a major Manhattan museum, and they politely declined. So this is also another painting that is related to defacement. It's called Back of the Neck. And it is a painting that is commonly thought of as just a random silk screen of his or a print of his, but it's much more than that. And when you look at the aspects of anatomy that he's chosen to highlight, they correspond directly to the causes of death for Michael Stewart. And speaking with the printer of this piece, it was also confirmed that Basquiat himself named this artwork, which was a very rare thing for him to do. In fact, Back of the Neck was Defacement, the Death of Michael Stewart, was named by Keith Haring. And so I have a photo of Keith Haring here as well. And so Keith Haring, with this, and also Defacement lived above his bed for until he died. And so kind of putting that into context of Defacement being above his bed, in 1985 he does this painting, Michael Stewart, USA for Africa, which is very, very dense, and is also related to the history of defacement. And so it's not quite clear, but that is a copy of a button that people were passing out in 1983 for Michael Stewart's justice. Michael Stewart's family, for a class that I recently taught at Williams, they graciously made copies of that for us. And you, and this image is not one of Michael Stewart that's in the public, but it shows that he has dreads, which is completely missing from the image of him in the public record. And so when Basquiat says it could have been me about Michael Stewart, that adds the physical similarities, add another layer of complexity. This is a picture of Michael, this is a picture of Michael, this is a picture of Michael Stewart, and I say date unknown just because I don't know the date that this was made, but just because I don't know it doesn't mean that it's unknown. And that's a quote from the Andy Warhol diaries. Andy Warhol also did a piece on Michael Stewart's death, and I'm in the process of also researching other artists that also possibly did her. And for any questions that you guys might have or information that I didn't have time to cover here, that is the website and all the information that you can take a screen grab up and learn more about it there.
Part of this was my responsibility to seek them out, I know. But I also took issue with the way American art history was centered on the white experience. So I said, I'm gonna do my own thing, go to institutions that specifically seek to empower and uplift the stories of people of color, and I found my people. My research was born out of a day-long U.S. Latinx Futures Symposium that was organized by artist Teresita Fernandez with the support of the Ford Foundation. I recently wrote a piece for Artsy called The Most Expensive American Artist is Latinx. That was me. It was a day-long, the U.S. Symposium was a day-long exploration of where U.S.-based Latinx artists found themselves. There was a discussion about the census data and its limitations in categorizing and counting the growing Latinx population, the lack of a market for Latinx art, the future of the canon of Latinx art history, and institutional representation of Latinx artists, the nuances of Afro-Latinidad and that invisibility, and the difference between Latin American and Latinx art. Artists talked about how they felt they were stuck in this liminal space in the art world and had to forge their own path and language to move forward. The art world, it seems, resists and is largely incapable of embracing and understanding hybrid identity, that most of us walk around with a double, triple consciousness of who we are, and that identity is always a plural condition, not a singular one. Examples of this are how we can be both Black and Latinx, or Filipino and Latinx. We are many things, simultaneously, all at the same time, and naturally, so is the art that we produce, and we should never have to choose between who we are. So, my research around Basquiat focuses largely on his experience as a both Latinx Puerto Rican. His mom was Puerto Rican, his father was Haitian, he was born in Haiti. And I talk a lot, I guess, when I first learned of Basquiat, he was mentioned as an African-American artist, an exclusively African-American artist, and it wasn't until I dug deeper that I was like, wait, oh, he's also Puerto Rican. And I'm like, okay, cool, like, that's mad people I know, I like that, and like, a lot of us are also Black and, you know, consider ourselves Afro-Latino and all of this, and so I was like, okay, so I started doing more research, and I'm like, okay, how could I not know that he was Puerto Rican? And then I found that in my community of color, everyone knew that he was Puerto Rican, because of course we love to claim our own people. And we're like, yes, did you know he's Puerto Rican? And I'd be like, okay, so we all know. And then I found that, like, when you talk about him, when you learn about him in art history courses, or you read any articles, he's always exclusively talked about as an African-American artist. And that is, I feel like, a kind of a way of simplifying identity and not kind of further complicating it, because it's easier that way. And I understand that he walked around this world and he walked around the United States and America and in this city in the body of a Black man. And he 100% absolutely was. But I was curious about his you know, the Spanish words that I often found in his paintings, and abuelita, which means grandmother, and the fact that he spoke Spanish. And so then I started researching the Latinx market. And I discovered that because the Latinx community in the United States, and especially in New York, is a marginalized one and disenfranchised and all of these things, that the art that was produced, Latinx art, was produced out of a social justice resistance. It was an art born out of kind of, you know, outcry and injustices uptown, and the Puerto Ricans that, you know, Puerto Rican community that lived uptown. And just raise your hand if you know what Latinx means. Okay. So,
hang on.
I will tell you now if you do not know. I know, I realized, I was like, I'm saying this word, but everyone might not know what it is. So Latinx is the gender neutral alternative to Latino, Latina, and Latina with the asterisk, and refers to numerous intersecting identities of Latin American and Caribbean descendants born or long living in the U.S. It also includes Brazil and Haiti, so it's not exclusive to Spanish-speaking countries. So that's what I mean when I say Latinx. So I was talking about, I have 2 minutes. So in this research, I found that that Latin American art, so what we think of like Frida Kahlo, Diego Rivera, Latin American art is often kind of plated with Latinx art, Latino art. But Latin American art has a huge backing and a foundation and tied to the elites from home countries. And also the Rockefeller family really saw to it to support and encourage and host exhibitions to showcase Latin American artists. Latinx art is not typically included in Latin American art narratives. So in the research that I did, I attended talks, symposiums, all this stuff, and I asked, okay, for example, at Phillips or in certain auction houses, there's no Latinx or Latino category, and Latinx artists are not included in American in the American art category. So there really is no category. If you look at an example is Carmen Rivera, who is blown up and is wonderful. She is often the fact that she was born in Cuba is always emphasized, even though she's lived and worked in New York for most of her life. So she's co-opted into these larger categories, of, for example, Latin American art, because that is more sexy, more attractive. I think it's more, it seems more exoticized and accessible. So my goal moving forward is to be a voice and expose as many and talk about as many Latinx artists that I can find and talk about what that means and all the complicated things that come with being part of this group of people that speak different languages, are different colors, different races, and not shy away from the complexity that that means. That you can also, that you can walk around and be from different places and speak different languages, and you don't have to choose a category that is digestible for the rest of everyone. And one of the things, my last point, I knew, so Government College did a study where they rounded up all the, they did data, they rounded up all the artists, the top artists or the top galleries in New York City, and asked like the race of each, or quantified the race of each artist. And they did, they kind of released what I already know. Latino artists are the most underrepresented demographic, making up only 1.2% of artists represented by New York galleries, despite being the largest. And it says minority, but I resist that so much because there's nothing minor about me. And so if you ever want to be an ally to people of color, think before you use the word minor because I'll check you. it's the largest ethnic group in the U.S., making up 16% of the nation's total population. And we're also, I believe we make up 28% of the entire city. And so the fact that there's only 1.2% is just wild to me. So anyway, that's it. Thank you.
for Basquiat, because a solo as one painting exhibition is really, really a focus on scholarship. And that really becomes less about the pageantry of exhibitions and catalog. And so when we chose Defacement, we were astonished that there was absolutely nothing on the painting. So even before we did the talk, which we had Franklin Sermons and Jordana Segese, who are tremendous Basquiat scholars, I had to do 6 months of research to even figure out what this painting was, because beyond the fact that he did it in response to Michael Stewart's death, there was absolutely nothing on it. So the fact that Keith Haring owned it, and the fact that back of the neck is related to it, that has all come from research. That has all come from the research that I've been doing for the last year and a half, 2 years. So to answer that question of what that means, it's I don't think people realize how anemic the scholarship is. It's really bad. And it's not just him, it's Keith Haring, it's Kenny Sharp, it's David von Abramovich, but for the focus we'll put on Basquiat. It's really bad. And what happens is that you have a generation of, you know, these schools that are supposed to be the stewards of art education in the world, not just in the academy, but curators and art critics and writers, they're not being educated formally or rigorously on artists like Basquiat. So you have another generation that are going through undergraduate programs or PhD programs, and they're not really getting much beyond kind of the pop culture commentary on him. And so, and when you look at, I recently wrote something for Apollo Magazine about the imbalance of the way that he moves in the market and the way that the scholarship moves, and we have to move beyond the retrospective model for his works and exhibition, and we have to move beyond exhibition catalogs, and that's no disrespect to the people that are doing that work, but you cannot get a PhD researching from an exhibition catalog. And exhibition catalogs have a particular focus in that they have particular demands that don't always lend themselves to more in-depth scholarship. And so while they're absolutely necessary, we have to get to a place where we have the focus on his work, like Picasso gets when we're looking at Demoiselle d'Avignon, or looking at his work beyond just when the market demands it or when an exhibition demands it.
We had actually had a terrific show along with Gallery of Put On by Mary Ann Fork a couple years ago, retrospective of his work. And he brought the fine artist, and he was also gay, which brought a whole other element into everyone's lives there. And to see Arch Connelly talking to some little kid in the neighborhood having a serious discussion about painting her artwork, her life in general, was just really, that was the fun gallery. So Eero did a terrific painting called Super Fresh. Here are small kids, because the guys would help them, you know, they would get some pre-stretched canvases and, you know, trade paint. We had the backyards, everybody could paint the backyard. And so I got Eero's painting Super Fresh in Newsweek magazine. And there was also a Keith Haring was in it too. It was an article about, you know, this whole, you know, new source of artwork, a new culture, because this is the thing. It, you know, the New York City schools have given up on these kids. They're altered, there was jail, drugs, or killing each other. That was the alternative. The school system was just forgetting. I mean, just like Ford said to New York City, drop dead. There was no alternative for them, and that's what the fascinating, you know, thing about it's the same thing with the punk rock, you know, is that hip hop just invented, okay, you don't want us to be part of your culture, that's fine, because it's actually really boring. So we're gonna just come up with our own culture. And so Eero, very proud of his article in this week. And took it to school and showed his teacher. And the teacher said to him, forget about this art stuff, you're never going to get anywhere with this. And that's what they told you. I'm just a little, I like, as you can tell, I like my revenge. Tony Shafrazi thinks so. I'm a dealer. I looked at that painting Super Fresh, and I said, five for $300. It's in Newsweek. And he calls me up and goes, Patty, I'll take that painting. I said, that's great, Tony, it's $1,000. He goes, what? Said, you had your chance, sold.
Okay, so I'll kind of have to answer this and then allow people to engage. How has the management of this state, the Boscata State, employed licensing and trademark of its work towards a platform against cultural appropriation and economic development for the artists? So I think, just like when I started this project with Chanel, I think that people, there's a certain, what do I want to say? People are drawn into Basquiat naturally, right? And I think that people expect, I think people are disappointed with the way that his image, his work, has been used. You know, Urban Decay is made of Basquiat makeup line. You know, obviously people know about Uniqlo. Yeah, people know about Uniqlo. But I think that really, at the end of the day, the purpose of an estate is to
talking from the academic perspective, but it's more like the popular culture. And a lot of millennials, I think young people gravitate towards him because he was very complex. And we don't have a lot of figures like that.
Now, I'm of two minds on this because on the one hand, I mean, he was very much like our generation was like the first brand new generation, you know, kind of world. He made t-shirts, collectibles, buttons. John never actually got into that when he was alive so much. But Kenny, right? Kenny has, there was a discourse that Warhol started that a lot of the artists of our generation took the first stab at was like having a way in which you can number one still make art for people, which was something that Keith and Kenny and like the graffiti artists they were making art for the people. It, you know, it could be in museums, but there was a real populist aspect to this world, number one. So it's not so different or so far afield from what was going on back in the day. Now, to what purpose is it? Is this money being used? I mean, I wish the foundation would have a scholarship. I wish they would be doing something maybe perhaps more socially responsible with the work and the money that was, you know, that's been being generated from Uniqlo t-shirts. But that's a different story. But I'm of two minds about that because I do see it as something that our generation, based on the way Warhol would find self-sustaining ways of working in the art world, which is very important. I always tell young artists, when Jean died, or you know, this whatever, it was a very low point in his life. And what I've seen in the study of the long lines of artists is that you always go through a period where people are not going to, you're not fresh anymore. And how do you sustain yourself during these lean times? And people like Keith and all of us, they were like, I'm going to create my own store. In fact, we would not call Fun Gallery the gallery. We would call it the store, Fun Gallery store. There was a whole way in which we wanted to change the terms and create a self-sustaining aspect of the work that could not be controlled by the dealer. So, you know.
Well.
You know that.
First of all, I've been dealing with the foundation and the stadium, the Basquiat Stadium, not on yet. I'm not going to really comment. First of all, both Kenny and Keith were alive, and Keith right. And Kenny, unfortunately, still is when they made this decision to popularize and sell this works. Keith first made his name with the little buttons. That was the first thing that you saw in the hearing were the little buttons with the radio baby. And you would hand them out because, yes, it was, again, you know, how the neighborhood kids would be affected by this. We did want to open up the art world so it was for everyone. Everyone has something to offer. They need to be given a chance. And so, yes, we did want to open that up. Now, John did it in a different way by doing the same of drawings and various other things. But people forget, and a number of the people on the Keith Haring Foundation forget, that when Keith did the Bob Shop, the entire established art world came down on him and said, he's not a fine artist, he's terrible, and this is, you know, he's just a graphic artist, blah, blah, blah. And I was one of the people that stuck up for him. I don't see it. Too many other people that are now, you know, putting out the thong underwear, the bathroom tissue, to that were there. I don't know. So I think that there's a lot, and again, I ask, what is the Keith Haring Foundation doing? Going